So, welcome to Physics 7C. I'm a high-energy experimental particle physicist, and I work on the Large Hadron Collider at CERN in Geneva. I even made the international press over the weekend. Well, it didn't mention me by name, but there's a picture of me standing on the platform of our experiment, CMS, at CERN, working on the detector last year. So it's an awesome place to be. You know, I love what I do. My two favorite places to work are there on that platform and here in this classroom teaching you all, because this is a fun course, I think. So, today's lecture is on the introduction to waves, which you, as I say, you've already seen a bit of in your first DL. In the course, in general, waves is going to underlie just about everything that we're going to do, really. So the first two lectures are about waves formally and properly, some traveling and standing waves, and interference and diffraction next week. And we'll move into optics, refraction, reflection, mirrors and lenses, how to make images with lenses. Then we will go into electromagnetism, including electric and magnetic fields, how you make electric and magnetic fields, how they look, how they're alike, how they're different. And then electromagnetic fields and radiation, bringing it kind of back around to waves. And then the final two lectures are on quantum physics, which is where we merge the ideas of waves and particles into this unified description of the atomic scale nature, which is very important for bio. All of these topics are very important, even in biological systems. It's important to understand these aspects of physics as you go on in the biological sciences, whether it's medicine or even dentistry. You know, I had teeth filled last week from root canals, and they used a pretty high-tech material that used quantum mechanics to harden the material when you get right down to it. And I can talk about that. When we talk about waves, what's the simplest overall definition we can make of a wave? It's a disturbance in some medium, whatever the medium might be. And the disturbance can be of lots of different natures. For example, and the mediums can be things that you wouldn't necessarily expect, like this wonderfully elastic plastic tube. Would you like to take hold of that? I'm going to walk way over here. And what am I going to do? I'm just going to pluck it at this end. And you can see that nice wiggle get transmitted all the way to the other end. And then it actually bounces and comes back. And maybe we'll see why that happens. So that's this spring is a wave medium. Thank you. And you can see that the wave has some shape. It was just a wiggle, a single wiggle, and it traveled. Here's another medium. What do we have here? We have a bunch of steel bars all welded onto a thin steel rod running down the middle here, such that if I wiggle one of these bars, it makes a twist in this rod running this way, and that twist causes the next bar and the next one and the next one to also twist, so it moves those bars. So if I perturb this one, you can see that perturbation travels from one end to the other, and so we've made a very simple wave medium here. Now, waves don't have to travel. If I'm good, I can set up a oscillation where, well, I'm not that good, I guess, but too much. There. It's sort of just standing there, a pattern which is just oscillating but not moving to the left or the right. It's what we call a standing wave. So how does that work? Well, we'll get to that. As you can see, wave behavior goes hand in hand with oscillatory motion. And the simplest oscillator that you dealt with, for example, at the end of physics 7b, is a mass on a spring. So if I take this mass and I raise it up and then just let it go, it oscillates with sinusoidal oscillations. And we'll make that mathematical in just a second. So what we want to develop today is the basic wave equation for one-dimensional waves. And you've already encountered this in the first DL, but let's build it sort of from the ground up. So starting with oscillatory motion, you remember that if you've got a mass on a spring, it has a restoring force F equals minus K times X. All right, K is the spring constant, and it tells you how strong the spring is, how much force it has given how much you've pulled on it or compressed it, either compressed it or stretched it. X is the coordinate of the mass. It's where the mass is in space. So if we move the mass to the right, it has a value x, then the force is minus kx, it points to the left. If we move the mass to the left, the force is to the right. That's what we mean by a restoring force. And you can see that even in this example, we have a restoring force, which is that the central rod here wants to be straight. It wants to retain its original configuration. When you twist it, it wants to twist back without any internal stress. So it's the same sort of thing. Almost any wave medium that you can come up with will have something that you can identify as a restoring force. And we'll, as we go through different wave media, we'll see what, they can be quite different. But it ends up being that in a wave medium, you have oscillations happening, and they end up more often than not being simple harmonic. You can describe them as simple harmonic oscillations. Now, the solution for the motion of the oscillator that you came up with in physics 7b at the end is x of t is equal to a cosine 2 pi t over the period big T plus phi, an overall phase. And remember that a, big A, is the amplitude of the oscillations. If this is the equilibrium position of the mass, we can call that x equals 0. When we pick it up to some height, the distance that I've moved it by is what we call A. So if this is x equals 0, this is x equals plus A. And I let go, and you can see it goes back down past the equilibrium point, x equals 0, to x equals minus A, and then back to plus A, and then minus A, over and over again. And it's doing that about once a second or so. Right? So the period of oscillations here is big T seconds, about 1 second. And oscillations can be arbitrarily fast or slow. And we'll get to the phase in a second. We can draw a graph of what this motion looks like and what that same equation says like this. And this really pretty precisely describes what's going on, because at time t equals 0, we have x equals a, the amplitude of the oscillations, and you let go, and you see you oscillate sinusoidally forever in time. Now, if there's no air resistance, no friction, it'll just keep going like that forever and ever. There's no reason for it not to do that. The period of oscillations is shown graphically here as the distance between two successive times at which the mass is at its highest position, x equals plus a. And so this picture goes along with this equation, 2 pi t over t plus phi.